the hot seat. This is Donovan Sadiq and me and Sean 14, and we are going to be talking about some mental health issues that are going on in Moreno Valley and some of the other issues going on. You know, we just don't do politics here. What we do, we talk about things that you guys want to talk about and discuss, and we are going to do that and get into it. And a special shout out today, we're being joined by Moreno Valley Unified School District candidate Daryl Terrell, the originator of Higher MoVal. He's going to sit in with us the first half, and then we're going to let Sean go again this week because he's going to be like looking up some dirt. So he's on special assignment, and we're just going to get into it. So, hey, Sean, it's been a nice, a good week. How you been doing?
I'm doing pretty good.
Okay, good, good. So what do you got for us this week?
Well, today I got a hold of Signature Healthcare, the company that has bought land on the Joint Powers property, and they're going to build a psychiatric hospital.
Oh, right.
They're going to have 150 beds. They're looking new ways to provide innovations. I suggested access to electronic communications like email and stuff would be nice if they can find a way to make that work with hospital privacy laws. But yeah, they plan on being a major partner in the community. And they plan on being a major host of support groups like AA and NAMI and all those as a place to have those meetings and provide the classes and community education. And I'm just incredibly thrilled that they're doing all this. And I'm glad that Highland Fairview's goons haven't screwed this up.
So, I mean, so when you say Highland Fairview goons, I mean...
I mean, Victoria Baca tried to sue the JPA.
Right,
we've got
right.
Gaiba, who's tried to dissolve the JPA. We've got Gutierrez. I don't know his deal. I don't think he's been told what to think yet. So, I mean, these people tried to scuttle this project in favor of the Aquabella Wellness Center
that never materialized. It's never going to materialize.
Yeah, it never materialized. According to Jemson, the Aquabella is not being pursued anymore. Highland Fairview has no interest in pursuing that project anymore. And, now we've got a company that has a track record of building hospitals and running hospitals that is going to build a hospital here, and they hope to have it open sometime in 2018.
So we're looking at about a year and a half.
Two years.
And then with that, you know, it's not just the hospital. With the hospital, what are some of the amenities that might come in addition to the hospital?
Well, they'll have outpatient programs, sure, which aren't as expensive, and you can get a lot more people into those. And since people go home at night, and you don't have to have a bed for everyone, and it's a lot less intensive as far as supervision and meds and everything. So you can have, like, instead of having like maybe like a group of 12, you can have like a group of up to 30 instead.
And, okay.
And there's time to get people into get their medications adjusted and also get them additional therapy and exposure to new types of treatments and also lifestyle adjustments. And there's finally going to be a facility in Moreno Valley that can do all that.
Now, in regards to that facility, is this going to be the only facility in the county?
There is one off of Brockton and Riverside, but that one's chronically full. County is chronically full and not being able, and they're not getting people effective treatment.
Okay.
So we have a chance to have a really nice change in the services available in the valley.
Well, you know what? That's kind of good to hear because, like I said, there's a whole bunch of other things that we could be building other than warehousing. And, you know, this is not to bash warehousing. Again, if the WLC survives the lawsuits, so be it. We got to move on. We got to move forward, try to make it work. But we have to start pivoting to other situations. I believe we have a great pool of retirees from the military, young military people that are injured, like you said, substance abuse.
We plan on offering some military services too.
Okay, so we can pivot and make this a medical what do you call that? Not like a medical town where you just have anything, but like a big medical campus to where you can treat all kinds of things. You know, and they talk about the WLC being world class. Why can't we have a world class, like a John Hopkins University type thing where we can teach medicine, nursing, doctoring, all these little things, and we have the resources and we have the patients. I mean, there's no doubt about that. So that's good news. And Sean was on special assignment. He's going to stay on top of that for us. You are going to stay on top of that for us.
Yes, I'm going to keep up. I'm going to keep track of that project, definitely.
Absolutely.
But also, I didn't get to go to the city council meeting last night. Unfortunately, I had another obligation. But I noticed in the news today they were talking about that they want to put, the city council is looking into a plan to have different groups sponsor different areas of the city. I don't know if they're like talking about like providing charitable services to like a group of neighborhood kids, maybe. But if they're trying to, but if they want to do anything like that with substance abuse or mental health services or any of that, if they want to divide that up by district or by neighborhood, then that's not going to work. If that's the case, they wouldn't understand. They don't understand the nature of the problem, because right now people go to, sometimes drive to other cities to find these types of support groups and stuff, and to try and divide it up by community or by district, that the only thing that's going to do is serve propaganda for election time. It's like, look at all these groups, all these community
factions,
groups I've got in my district, and well, there's not really getting, not really being able to access to many people if they're only being advertised and marketed to
certain demographics.
Neighborhood.
Right. Well, you know, one thing about this city council that doesn't impress me at all is there's no forethought and there's no master planning ahead of time to look at that. So hopefully, when the election comes, we might have some new candidates that kind of understand you have to think ahead of the problem. So hopefully that'll be a good thing.
Yeah, it seems like they didn't actually have a plan. They just told, from what I'm reading, they just told the city manager to come up. They want the city manager to come up with something for this. It's like all of a sudden it's on their agenda all of a sudden.
Oh, right. Hey, like I said, it's election season. It sounds good. People like the way it sounds.
It's another example of now that we bring it up, they're suddenly interested, and that's why I didn't attend their town hall a few months ago, is because I knew they were just looking to find out what I want to hear, so they can tell it to me and try and get me to vote for them, and they'll just do the same old thing. They have no idea what they have no idea how to handle mental health stuff. Most people up there see social issues through the lens of economics, when there's a lot more going on inside someone personally that affects the kinds of decisions they make more than just being poor. And they don't understand that, and I don't really expect I don't expect us to ever get a mayor and a city council that all of them are on the same page as far as, hey, look, there's more to this than economics. But that's why I keep suggesting that we need to have an advisory board for the city council and for our emergency services, and to talk to the hospital and the support groups as they become available, so that we can get all these services coordinated and get people
the help they need.
Yeah, people to understand get the people in city hall to understand what the community needs, and get the community connected with those services.
Yeah, unfortunately, we've got representatives that just, they're in the office for the access. They don't really care about the people. It's about the access and power and all that other good stuff. But that's a good thing. And like I said, Sean's going to stay on top of that. We are at the Starbucks on Fredericks Street, and you can come on down and have a Starbucks with us and sit down. But you know, it's been excessively windy, and we have the mufflers on, and I think next week that we're going to move location and go into the mall, because the mall has some issues that we want to talk about and highlight. What do you think about that?
I think that sounds good, and
they have some good coffee up there too.
Yeah, so they have some good stuff there still. But also, while we're talking about mental health, Daryl Terrell, he was on the behavioral health board. What do they call it? Oh, the County Riverside County Behavioral Health Commission. And he did a meeting for that today. And so, how did that go?
Well, the meeting was very insightful, because we have providers, and we call celebration of people who've turned their lives around. and it's more that you see what the kind of service that the county provides to the citizens of our community. That there's a lot of issues that I didn't even know that exist in the county, or even in our city, where people come there from providers. And we also do Mental Health Month in May, and in May, it was a very good month. And like I said, when you get to hear somebody who turned their life around, you just, your heart just you want to cry.
It pours out for them.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
Because this commission is to look out for our people, provide them with the resources they need to get them back on the right track.
Okay.
And not only that, you see parents who have kids that have different types of issues, and they tell you what the county's programs have done. And you learn a lot from it. So, I mean, I'm blessed to be on this commission because I could see hope visible in their people. And we take tours of clinics and we do evaluations of how the services are. And you got a lot of bright people that serve on that commission. And I invite anybody to come down there the first Wednesday of the month to come to our meetings down in off of Rusting in Riverside at 12 p.m.
Wow. Okay.
This is exactly what I'm hoping to get for a smaller version of that in Moreno Valley. That way, even if we have to use crayons on a big easel and sock puppets, that we can get the city council and city staff to understand what we need.
Right, absolutely. And like I said, we have Mr. Terrell has joined us, and he's always sat in the audience over here having a cup of coffee with us and watching and seeing how we do this. And we've invited him, and he's finally accepted our invitation. He's ready to come out and tell you a little bit about himself for those of you that don't know. Darryl Terrell is a longtime resident here, and he is currently running for the Moreno Valley Unified School District School Board. And I believe that's Area 2?
Oh, yes, it is.
Area 2, and again, this is the man who is the originator of Hire MoVal and a lot of other initiatives that he has put into the public record. And all you have to do is go to the city website and look at the archive videos, and you will see Darryl up there talking about all kinds of different ideas and initiatives that the city could do to bring jobs, to bring help, could bring, you know, I mean, ideas out the wazoo. And a little bit about your background a little bit there. So Darryl, thank you for coming on the show. And one thing I want to ask you is, basically, I think everybody should be asked this question. And, you know, it doesn't matter how long you've been here and like that. Everybody's an implant except me and maybe a few of us that are left alive. But tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I came out here in 1988. I always tell the story. You remember the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air? I was like Will Smith.
Right.
I was wild and crazy. But I needed a change in life, so my aunt and uncle were stationed at March, gave me the opportunity for affordable higher education. I came out here. I went to school at RCC, where I received an AA and an AAS, and I got a BA from the University of California, Riverside. And I've served on many commissions. Like, I served on the Traffic Safety Advisory Committee from 1997 to 2004. When they had the leadership Moreno Valley, I was in the first graduating class in 1996.
Oh, wow.
I was a member of the Veterans Affairs Committee back in 1992.
Okay.
And I served on the ad hoc committee. We had to find some money to balance the Zone A funds. This was in 1993. And I'm currently serving on the Riverside County Commission for Behavioral Health Services.
Right.
So a lot of my activities has been, as you're seeing me on TV, is to present ideas that can improve the quality of life, put police on the street, put people back to work. And some of my ideas have saved the city $6 million.
Oh, my gosh, yes.
It helps balance the budget. And these things are because I presented the budget. Because, you know, sometimes people go up there and they complain, but they never present a solution to any problems.
Yeah. Preach, brother, preach!
You claim that you saved the city $6 million. That's going to be challenged. So can you elaborate on what areas you saved the money from?
Well, when I presented a budget, I presented my own alternative budget. I put in a 4 to 10 work week, which reduced. Also, a pay cut, which I presented this all in the public record. I got a list of items, and when the council does things, I go back and check because I know I talked about it, and if someone wanted to ask me, I could show I could prove it to them.
Right.
Because I got the budget I presented.
Right.
And also some of the ideas that, like I said, the 4 to 10 work week, using some of the reserve, changing the general fund contingency from 15% requirement to 10%, I think it was. So money could go into to fund public safety, like police officers.
Right.
And then there was an idea that I put forth to put more police officers on the street by using the reserves. Mm-hmm. And some people say you shouldn't do it, but I'm looking at it like this. At this time, we needed police officers. And the council followed that lead and did it.
Right.
So to me, when you put out ideas, I do research on it. And sometimes I could be wrong.
Sure, absolutely.
But those ideas have implemented. And just like, remember the business tax amnesty program?
Yes.
Well, that was one of the ideas I put out forth. Or the registry for home. I forgot what it's called. But there were some ideas that helped to restructure our fees in the city.
Okay.
And like when it comes to fixing up your buildings or small business, they give them a chance to free up some money so they can invest it back to their business.
Their businesses, yeah, I remember that. Okay, so let me ask you this real quick. You know, you have all these great ideas, which to me you should be running for the district council, one, because I know for one I would be voting for you. But you are voting, you are running for school board. Now, why did you decide to run for school board versus council?
When I look at the issues over the last 2 years that I've been talking about, job training, building the bridge to the American dream, it all starts back with the educational system. Because in order for us to bring in a business with high quality jobs with a higher pay, that we have to have an educated, skilled workforce. And so when I went to the city council and I started talking about raising the bar and talking about ways that we could create a German-style hybrid apprenticeship training program, mm-hmm. working with Moreno Valley College and the business community, I thought, well, it could work better with the kids in high school. Because a lot of these kids go off to high school, and some of them go off into poverty.
Right.
But the reason why they go off into poverty is because they're not prepared. We have career tech programs that expose kids to careers that's out there, but no path to a job. They say, okay, you're exposed to the careers. Now, you're off and running. So my whole thing is to focus my efforts to help those young people. So when those go off to college, they will be prepared. But also those kids who doesn't want to go to college, whatever reason, he wants to make it in the real world, but make him have a path where we have apprenticeship. Like, there's business in this community that pay real good. I talked to two business owners that were willing to have a training program, like 4 hours in the classroom, 4 hours on the floor. And you can earn not only a high school diploma, you can get a certificate. But not only that, you will have a job when you finish the program. So that kind of tells you why. I'm looking at it like this. If we want to get the top notch, like you guys are talking about healthcare, diversify our economy, then we got to have the educated, skilled workforce to do it. And the high schools is a pruning ground so we can do that. But it has to be that we have to leverage our resources and our costs. We got to share the costs because business don't want to just say, I'm going to put up the money.
Right.
The city has to do it. The school district has to do it. And Moreno Valley College working together build this path.
Yeah, I really like that because when I was in high school, I was just in a routine to just get through high school and get my diploma. And when I got out of high school, I had no clue what I was doing. So that would be great. But also, I'm thinking it would be nice also if we had some programs for to teach manufacturing skills, because I've been saying we've got we've got some capacity left for in the city to set up light manufacturing, and quite frankly, I would love to take some classes myself that involve manufacturing, but unfortunately right now all that's in Norco, RCC Norco, and so I really like your ideas, because if we have the people that under no manufacturing, then maybe they'd be inclined to come set up a small business that involves the manufacturing skills that they've learned.
And that brings up a good point. Recently in the news, ITT has filed for, I guess they're going out of business, and that's a vocational college, even though they call themselves, you know, and a lot of the students that invested their time into that college now don't know if those are worth anything or whatever, you know, whatever their particular situation is. And, you know, if we're going to be investing in these high-tech warehouses or whatever you want to call them, like you said, the Norco campus has the thing over there where they're going to do that, you know, why can't we come up with an idea where you have business like what you're talking about? Because not everybody wants to go to college, you know, they want to get in there and, and do what they got to do real quickly.
Yeah, and both the medical field and manufacturing would provide a degree of stability to our economy. To make some recession resistance, because like if we've got warehouses, I mean, like you've got people working at warehouses right now. You've got the Hanjin Shipping Company. Yeah. They're bankrupt and they've got ships just sitting off the coast because they can't afford port fees. I mean, so it's like if we have manufacturing, skilled manufacturing using American sourced mills, then we have a opportunity to make the city more recession resistant than it has historically been.
Right, and like I said, a lot of people are coming out of high school, like you're saying, Daryl. They're coming out of high school, and not everybody's college material. That ain't what they want to do. And I think one of the problems is, like you said, you know, here's your diploma, good luck. But there's no bridge between the high school and the college to get these kids in a direction. Everybody, to me, as a longtime resident, to me, it's ridiculous that my son is going to stay where he was born and raised. I would rather have my son move to Hawaii where I can go visit him, but that's just me personally. But if you can elaborate on that type of thing, because, you know, you're running for school board and you have all these great ideas, and I think I see where you're going with it, but could you elaborate on how you would make that go?
Okay. For instance, like you were saying how Norco had the certificate. Wouldn't it be nice if they had teamed up with a Karma or light manufacturing, and when you went through that program, there was a job waiting for you. You know how these for profits are? They promise you this. It would be nice now to elaborate how we would do this. For instance, say a business like a widget factory decided they want to come into the city. What we would have to do is go to them, bring the Moreno Valley College representative, and say, here's what we do. We have a prototype apprenticeship program. And what we're going to do, we're going to leverage our money. The city of Moreno Valley is going to leverage their money. Moreno Valley College is going to leverage their money. And we're going to create an apprenticeship training program where our resident, say, for instance, like Mr. 14, he wants to, and say, because we're leveraging the money, we'll pay for his education. Or we could get grant money. Grant money is out there at the federal and state level. And he'll go through the program for, like I said, four hours on the floor hours. On the floor in the classroom. So after when he finishes, he would get a certificate, but he would be training for a job that's existing right that moment,
right,
that they haven't even filled yet, and he will go right into that job. Exactly.
Yeah, that's another good point, because when I did get out of high school, since there was no way I was going to pass the medical fitness test to join the Marines, I was going to be a music major, but I knew that wasn't going to pay bills right away,
right,
so I was going to need another skill.
Right.
And I guess on a side note, the girl I was talking to said she wanted to take women's studies, and my question was, how are you going to pay the bills? Oh, and she got so pissed.
Right.
But anyways, I knew right away what I wanted to do. I knew that was going to take time, and I knew right away I was going to need another skill, but I wasn't able to do both at the same time at the moment.
Okay, great. Something that was just posted today, as you know, a lot of fact-finding and things like that. Congratulations on your endorsement by the Teamsters. That's a very hard thing to get. I know that for a fact, because those guys, if they don't believe in what you're doing, if they're behind you, that says a lot. So congratulations on that. I mean, can we just tell you, are you Mafia connected, or
No. No.
Right.
We'll know if he suddenly disappears.
Yes, exactly. Because maybe I might need a favor dealing with somebody else. But that's a great accomplishment, because that is a very hard endorsement to get. And I don't see other candidates doing that. Now, speaking of other candidates, you're in a tough race. So there's no doubt about it. You're in a tough race. Kevin Geiser, he is a candidate coming down through. And he's a, you know, up-and-coming guy and has some connections. But, you know, you've been in the community for a long time. So what's your vision once you do get on the school board?
Well, my first top is, as you have seen over the last year or so, how the district in the city has strained relationships.
Yes.
And it's time for us to have a real come-to-Jesus moment where we all sit at the table. And because the most important thing we have to think about is our kids. And I've been telling people about building a bridge to the American dream for these kids. And it's going to take all of us in this community. And so the first thing to get Dr. White and the city manager and all of us together is talk strategy. How are we going to build this bridge? And the building that bridge, as I said before, is that pathway, the apprenticeship program. That's one of the ways.
One of the ways.
Another way we can do it, you know how the city of Riverside they came together to have completion counts.
Okay.
And you mean, what that does is, a kid graduates from a high school in Riverside, they get the first priority of the classes at Riverside City College.
Right.
But Moreno Valley doesn't have that.
They don't have
it. Now, what they did, the mayor of the city of Riverside and the school board and Riverside City College, they got together to form a plan. But it was something much more than priority classes. There were other things to get people in touch, like filling out the financial aid, free, you know, the application. There's free money out there for kids to go to school. We got to increase that. But those things together could help us bridge the gap of our differences.
And okay, let's say you have the sit-down meeting, and let's say the city council has their own plan that has nothing to do with the price of tea in China, as far as they have their own agenda for their own purposes that isn't compatible with what's actually going on in the school district. Do you compromise with them for the sake of compromise, or do you dig in your heels, or what?
Well, one thing people know me as, I'm not a rubber stamper, and I'm independent. But we have to, because you look at here's the big issue that we all face in this community, poverty.
Yeah.
Poverty is the biggest issue that unites all of us. Now, if they can't see, the city doesn't see that if you don't have an educated workforce, you don't have kids that will go off and never come back to the city because there ain't no jobs in this community. So they're losing an important revenue maker, these young people. And so to answer your question is that, yeah, I have to dig in, but the compromise is this: do we want our people, do we want their parents to continue to live in poverty without no way out, live on islands of poverty? So my thing is to get the council to see that point, because here's his instance, because I've gone to council meetings and pretty much people may agree with me or not agree with me, but they're used to seeing me. I could be that bridge to bring these folks together. Where some people that have never been to, you know, a council meeting, or I've been to the school board meetings, but people respect enough to sit down and talk, and that we could come together. Even though they're digging their heels, but one thing will get them to come to the table: our people are living in poverty. There'll be no way out unless we work together. If they want their people, our people, our young people, to live on islands of poverty the rest of their life and see our city go downhill, then they're going to have to come together.
Okay, we're going to go ahead and pay some bills here. We are at the Starbucks on Fredericks, and Mean Sean 14 is going to go on special assignment. He's going to leave for the break. And we're going to continue talking with Darryl Terrell and ask him some more questions about his candidacy there. So stay tuned. Okay, we are back, and Mean Sean 14 has left the scene. Ooh, that rhymed. And we are in to Starbucks in Fredericks, on Fredericks, and we're having a nice latte and having a nice conversation with Moreno Valley Unified School District candidate Darryl Terrell, and he is running for the school board, and he has a lot of great ideas. If you see, hear a lot of music in the background, that is Starbucks and their radio station. But a lot of wind out here, so next week, we are going to be at the mall, at one of the coffee shops there, one of the businesses, because we're going to try to highlight some of the businesses going on in Moreno Valley. And also, do not forget, September 25th, we are having a candidate debate. It is set. And if you want to know and hear from some a mayor candidate and John candidates, please come out. It's going to be at the Edgemont Community Center. So please come out, and you might even run into other candidates running. I'm very sure Darryl might stop by and see what's going on, because, you know, that's part of the school district that he would be covering, so he needs to be handling that. So, back to what we were saying, didn't mean to cut you off on the last broadcast, but if you could elaborate a little bit more about what you were alleged to.
What's that?
What you alleged to in the last thing about the poverty and the connection between the two.
Okay, as you know, in our community, there's a poverty. Well, I think the last I saw the American Community Survey, there was 41,000 of our residents that's living in poverty right
now. Wow.
25,000 that are working or work for in this community.
Welcome. I'm one of them.
But you know, as you know, that the jobs that are coming by 2025, I should say, is that the jobs are going to require something beyond high school, less than a four-year degree. So when we look at, have you ever noticed we have all these check cashing places and we have these rent-to-own places around here?
Right.
And one question bothered me, why are they here? They're here because there's a need for it.
Okay.
Because people, some folks don't have a, can't get a bank account.
Right.
So they are a predator to these businesses. So when you talk about poverty and you want business to come in here, they come here because of an educated, skilled workforce, which we do lack. Okay. And in order for people to go into the middle class, they got to have some education beyond high school, less than a four-year degree, or some kind of skill training. So my thing is, what I was mentioning to you about apprenticeship programs and training programs with our city, and I pushed that over to the school district, is the fact that if we show the business community out there that we can raise the bar when it comes to college education attainment levels, and we can train people by showing them we have an apprenticeship program or slash training program, they will come here. Because, in fact, when they come here, they're going to see this program, and we're going to link up together, and residents could go in and get a decent job, because they'll be training for the jobs that's in that facility.
Okay.
So they're not just going to be just training and say, here's your certificate, see you later.
Okay, you know, and that's a good idea, but I have a question for you.
Okay.
And it really hit me in my mind just now. Okay, we have converted this city into a warehouse city. So let's say we do an apprenticeship program like you do. What to keep that kid from taking that training and going to where he can make that real good paying job, because we don't have it here?
Well, you remember we were talking about the medical field. Like,
yeah.
We got you know what Riverside County is having? They're expanding their medical center, their
right.
University Center.
Right.
But see, the thing is, then we have Karma here. And as you were saying, what would stop that kid from taking the skills somewhere else? Because once we have a program like that, business is going to want to come here. They want to come here because we have shown them we got a viable path.
Educated workforce.
That's right.
Right, out of high school.
So, yeah, when that kid goes to a logistics center, like a Skechers or what other warehouses, but what they're going to find out, there's going to be other type of businesses coming here, diversifying our economy, that's going to want to come here because they say, no, well, yeah, we kind of lack an educated, skilled workforce, but we creating a path so they could get into the middle class, jobs to have economic mobility.
Okay. And that's great, and that sounds awesome. And like I said, you have a lot of ideas here. Do you think with this WLC, because that's the elephant in the room right now, because this thing is coming if it survives the lawsuits. And even if it doesn't survive the lawsuits, it's just going to be reconditioned, and they're going to try to make them adhere to CEQA. Is it possible that this idea could go to Highland Fairview and they would adopt this? Because this is something that I think that they would want to push to create these jobs.
Well, see, that's the thing about it. See, when you have a Highland Fairview, it's possible that they'll do it. But right. See, it takes leadership from the city council to... And like I said, because Highland Fairview can't do it, they can't do it by itself. Because it's here, and it's here to stay. Only thing we can do as a community, if it comes and it comes to tuition, is to work, like again, with the partners of our school district, again, Moreno Valley College, the county, and work together to build that. Working together, because one entity is not able to do it. It's going to take all of us together to do it.
Right. So, so that's one of many ideas that you have. And I'm trying to talk about jobs. You know, for some reason, people think city council people and school board members can wave their wands and all jobs appear and things like that. We don't have truck infrastructure. So that's another thing. So let's say I'm graduating high school and I wanted to be a truck driver, or I want to work at a transmission shop for trucks like that. Remember when we were in high school, you had auto shop. You learned that, which is a vocational skill that you did, and you can go right into that. So this idea to me sounds like it could supplement the WLC in the future if we can get this thing off the ground and have these businesses that have the infrastructure that supports the truck infrastructure to support the WLC.
Well, yeah, I agree with you, because the reality is you're gonna need an infrastructure. You're gonna need a support system to support those trucks and to take care of the trucks. And as you were saying, that's gonna help create a pipeline for people to learn those skills, because it's gonna be needed. The reality
is
what you're talking about is gonna be needed.
Right.
No doubt in my mind. Because you just can't put up a facility
of that magnitude
and not have a support system that would take care of the trucks. And also, you're right, you gotta have hotels, you gotta have all the, I guess you call them, amenities.
Right, truck stops, truck washes. Yeah. I mean, if you're an entrepreneur listening to this right now, and you can't wait until the WLC is built, by then it's too late. You got to start doing this stuff now.
Yeah, and I agree. Because those crazy, a lot of people don't understand, man, you can make good money.
Absolutely.
And you can create that economic mobility out of poverty. And that will create a lot of opportunities for people to learn a skill that will get them out of poverty.
Right.
Because that's the main thing we have to think about. We got to get people out of poverty. And these kids that go into the Moreno Valley Unified School District, a lot of them, 25% of them live in poverty. And that would be a good thing for even for the parents to learn the skills. If they want a better job, or if they have the skills and stuff.
At least have some options other than saying, I'm going to work in a restaurant in Moreno Valley, or I'm going to work in a warehouse in Moreno Valley. We're just going to have different options other than. Like I said, we are a warehouse city. I don't care what anybody has to say. This city is now a warehouse city. And if we're going to be a warehouse city, we have to have the infrastructure to support a warehouse city. And not everybody's college bound. One of the biggest, a lot of people don't want to believe this, the biggest vocational school in the world is the United States military. You go in there, they teach you a job, whatever that job is, and you come out, you actually do it. Of course, the Air Force is the only one that gives you a degree for that, but it is the biggest vocational skill in the thing. And if we want our kids to stay in Moreno Valley, we've got to put these ideas to the test. Like I said, or at least have a discussion about it. What's going to make you, as a school board member, negotiate, you know what I mean? What's going to be different about you as a school board member versus the current ones that we have, to where there's this animosity between the council and the school board?
We have to show leadership. We cannot sit around and wait for somebody else to do something for us. As a school board member, I would want to show leadership. That's my ability. That's my instinct to make things happen, to work with other people, work with the city council. Even if there may be people that I may disagree with fundamentally, but the same thing is, there's a common purpose that we all have in this community. We want our kids to have a chance to live their American dream. and we want the parents of those kids. And to me, I'm not a rubber stamp. I'm definitely not a rubber stamp. But what I want to do is to build that bridge. Build the bridge with the school district, because that got to happen.
Right.
And people say, well, things are a lot better. It's not. It's not a lot better. We see each other as two different entities.
Right.
Two separate entities. The city and the school district. One in one corner and the other corner.
One's talking Chinese, one's talking French.
Yeah. So
let me ask you this. Canyon Springs doesn't have a stadium. What is your take on the Canyon Springs stadium situation versus the Markham, who wants the stadium built near the Markham Academy? I'm not really up to speed on that, but you know what I'm talking about. Canyon Springs doesn't have a stadium. So if I was a parent, I don't know your opinion on getting that done.
Well, I mean, where I came from, every high school had a football stadium.
Right.
And my thinking is this. They should have a high school stadium.
Okay.
That's what I think.
Huh, where's my sister at?
That's what I think, that they should have a high school stadium. I think all the schools, if they can afford it, if it doesn't impact on traffic in the neighborhoods, they should have it.
We're building a new high school. What is your opinion? And give me a name for that new high school. I was thinking the Darryl Terrell High School of...
No. You know what I was sitting here thinking when you was asking that question? I thought about Norma Lopez. The young person that was murdered.
Yes.
I think we should name it after her, because she had a bright future.
Yes, she did.
And she lost her life because of some evil in our community. And I think that high school should be named after her.
Okay.
Because she was a young person that had a bright future.
Right. Now, another question I have. Like I said, you know this is news from Edgemont. This is the Hot Seat Radio. We recently demolished Edgemont Elementary. And you know it's being rebuilt and everything like that. Is there anything that you want to say? And you know that was a historic elementary school, and it was long overdue to get refurbished. It's going to be high tech, a lot of things that it should have. But in that area, we still have kids walking, with no sidewalks, things like that. Is there a way that the school board and the city, like you were saying, working together, could solve some of these problems to where some of these kids can walk to school without walking in the street?
Well, yeah. I think, see, as a school board trustee, if I'm fortunate to be elected for that area, I would have a partner with the city council member of that area to work together, go in together, and let's get these sidewalks built for these kids, because they do not need to be walking in the street on dirt. There's no sense for that. They need to have sidewalks because Edgemont has been left behind. As many times it has been left behind. And I think we, as a community, we cannot afford to let these kids, they deserve to have the best like everybody else does.
Absolutely.
And working with that district representative, we can do it.
Yeah, hopefully that representative will be me, but that's to be determined. But to me, it just doesn't make sense to have this new hybrid high-tech elementary school, and then all around it still looked like it's the 1960s or the 1950s. I'm just saying there's got to be a way where the city and the council person of that district together and try to make it a little bit better for the residents that live in that neighborhood.
Well, yeah, it's gonna, like I said, it's gonna take the representative and the school board member, if it's me, to work together. And also, it's going to take, we can work with the private sector too, and to maybe to do a private partnership, private-public partnership, to get that area up. Sure. That's my thing. I think the private sector has a direct benefit from this.
Right.
But it also is going to take other entities in our community. It's going to take federal, maybe it's going to take state. And us working together to make sure that those kids in the surrounding areas get to be brought up to this century.
This century, absolutely. Thank you so much. That is Darryl Terrell. Mr. Darryl Terrell is running for the Moreno Valley Unified School District, Area 2. And we wish him all the best of luck. We thank you for coming on the show. This has been the Radio Hot Seat. I'm Donovan Sadiq. And Mr. Terrell, please come back and visit us again. You are welcome anytime.
Oh, thank you very much. I really appreciate it, Mr. Sadiq.
All right, we'll talk to you.